of you who don't know me, and I'm going to come out to you guys. I've been doing this 30 years, and I got into comics because I had no qualifications to do anything else. Just get that out of the way right now. My son, the other night, I attended an honor society for him. He's a junior, and he was inducted to the honor society at his private school that I pay an arm and a leg for. Yeah. And he pulled down like a 4.5, and I go, how did you get this intelligence? It's not from me. And I love my wife, and it's not from her either. All of his athletics and all his that, he got from my wife. But when I was a kid, I was like, I can't be a lawyer. That involves studying. And I can't be a doctor. That involves being smart. You don't want me opening up the chest. I just knew. Comics is my passion. Comics is my love. But literally, there was a lot of panic. That's why I broke it at such a young age. I was auditioning to be a comic book artist since I was 12 years old. And my English teachers would send the notes home. You tell Rob to stop drawing on his, tests. And I'm like, what? Can I tell you to be a better teacher? You suck. But the thing is, I was always drawing. My best and my favorite, and I love him dearly. That's not true. I kind of love him. My art teacher at my school in my junior year, I was drawing panel to panel because I already knew. I'd gone to enough conventions like you guys, and I would go and I would meet George Perez and Frank Miller and all my idols, and they were swell and wonderful people. And they'd say, Rob, I'm a kid. They'd say, you got to, draw sequentials. You got to draw sequentials. You have to tell a story. If you can't tell a story, you can't draw comics. So, I was working on my storytelling panel to panel since I was in high school. And my teacher, Mr. Jenberg, he said, I don't think there's much future in that. I still, and I'm like, oh, not another roadblock. Because, again, this is 1983, 84, and I'm like, okay, totally uneducated, doesn't even read comics, but he's telling me I shouldn't even try to break into comics. And I'm like, I go to the comic store, there's a million comics. There's Marvel Comics, First Comics, Eclipse Comics, Dark Horse Comics. The business was booming. And my art teacher was just another hurdle. He said to me, you should do what Billy does. And I looked over, and I'm like, give me a friggin' break. Billy was drawing a plate of fruit. And I'm like, I drew a plate of fruit when I was six. Like, I'm past the plate of fruit, I'm doing comics. And but the guys that I grew up with, Frank Miller, and he's become like, and I get it, because I've been that polarizing guy. He's become polarizing, which is nonsense to me. He is like, when I talk to my wife about comics, she just, she tries to pay attention. But she's like, oh my God, he's paying for dinner, I have all this to happen to this thing. But I'll be like, Frank Miller changed comics! This is last night over at this restaurant over here in the Cove River. I said, he changed them visually and writing. But like Alan Moore, you can say he changed things writing-wise, but Frank Miller impacted the way we look, absorb, the way comics are drawn. And, the one thing about him also, he's very daring. He doesn't care about what any of us think. He draws the way he likes. So anyway, those guys, Frank Miller created Electra. When I was a kid, Electra was a big deal. Daredevil, he turned that book around. Walt Simonson took Thor and made a horse the star of the character. The star of the book. I was like, there's a horse in Thor's clothes. And this is 1984, and I'm like, and he's smashing Thor's logo. These are the comics I grew up with. John Byrne, Alpha Flight. And obviously, the birth of Wolverine. When I was a kid, I related to Wolverine. I had a little bit of a hot temper. And I was a little bit of a rebel. I liked Namor, Wolverine, and Hercules, Marvel's Hercules. And they all had one thing in common, and they were all kind of assholes. And so little Robbie Asshole had all these assholes to look up to. So, kids, I'm sorry. I won't be as R-rated as the Deadpool movie, but I'm tired. The thing is, I was able to break in at 18 years old. I just drew and drew and drew on my own. I'd go to conventions like these. I'd meet with editors. Sometimes, the best thing I ever did, I would stand off to the side while an editor would review someone else's work. And I would listen. And again, I'm telling you, if you want to be in the business, listen to what that editor is saying. They have the power to hire you. They have kind of a... Marvel, DC, all the publishers have a certain standard they want you to adhere to. And it would be awesome to see people argue with them. And they'd be like, well, buddy, these three pages, here's everything you did wrong. And I'd see these people, I'm like, okay, I know enough to know that you just poured gasoline on yourself and set yourself on fire, dude, with the samples. They'd be like, this isn't clear what's going on here. What do you mean this isn't clear? What do you mean? Well, you're not going to get to work with me. And I'm like,
is that like really bad for anybody?
I'm sure that guy is still trying to break any bonds. Because I was like, you're not helping anybody. Don't be the guy that argues with the editor. Listen. And so I listened and listened and listened. Now, 18 years old, a guy, my buddy, his name was Hank Canals. You will see his name in every DC comic book. Hank Canals and I were buddies. He lived in Corona. I would drive out a half hour every day. We did APAs. There were Amateur Press Association magazines. We were such fanboys. We would pick George Perez up from the airport when he flew to Anaheim for the Creation Con and drive him to El Torito because we were teenagers and that's what we could afford. And, you know, so I knew my way around comic professionals. And a little known random fact, you go by Teen Titans number 50. Maybe it's Tales of Teen Titans 50, but it's The Wedding of Donna Troy. And towards the end, in the wedding book, my name is in it. You will see Rob Liefeld drawn in blue ink, because George was my boy. He was. I would have been actually drawn in the book, but like an idiot, I didn't send my photo in. So that will tell you, like, Liefeld's been a geek a long time. He loves this. But so Hank Canals and I drove to Oakland, California, to the very first WonderCon, and every publisher turned me down. And when I mean turned me down, they wouldn't look at my work. They said, we're not accepting samples. We're not accepting samples. We're not accepting. So I was like, this sucks. Like, I drove 6 hours and everyone is giving me my samples back. Well, Marvel Comics was the last table. DC Comics said, well, thank you. We'll take these back to New York and look at them. But all these other publishers, Dark Horse, First Comics, Eclipse, all these guys at the time, no interest. No interest. I'm like, fuck, I'm getting out of here. More careless, okay. So anyway, they weren't accepting. Well, hey, let's rob. Former champion, go talk to Marvel. So I went and talked to Marvel. And I stood in line. And single file, well approached. A guy named Mark Grunewald, God bless him. He was the editor there. He took my panels, my pages. I had 8 pages of a book called Youngblood because I was going to self-publish, and had all the Youngblood characters on it. And he looked at them and he shuffled them like cards. He kept taking one out, looking at two, putting another. And you know what it was? The Youngblood was an audition of a superhero to another bunch of superheroes, and the guy argues and doesn't like what they're telling him, and then they kind of toss him out, and then they walk to a weight room, and they all talk while they're working out, and then the alarm goes off, and they all fly out, 8 pages, but a lot of talking, a lot of people walking down the halls, but just character interaction. It wasn't like Spider-Man swinging across rooms, battling the Green Goblin. And suddenly, Mark Grunewald stops, and he puts him down, he looks up at me, looks down, looks up at me, and he starts to rise. I'm sorry if I've told this before. And he starts to rise because it's going to be embedded in my head forever. And he rises. And in my head, I hear, and then his hand is going across the table. Whoa, slow-mo. And he goes, welcome to Marvel Comics. And I'm like, are you freaking kidding me? Like, this was like a biblical story. Like, everyone turned me down at the last minute. Made of gold said, come on in, we have a manger for you. I mean, I was like, no way! And he said, I'll have something for you in a couple of weeks. And true to his word, I did a bunch of Marvel Universe Handbook stuff. And I have been in the business so long that I have now forgotten crap that I've done, so now I'm like an old guy, for real. Like, somebody, the Legion of Superheroes is like my favorite super team ever. DC currently doesn't publish them, and anyone on the convention circuit or in Southern California knows that Rob Liefeld has been in their stores, rifling through their Legion comics, going, what do you have more Legion comics? They're trying to buy my childhood. Well, I forgot that I did a whole bunch of Legion entries in this thing called the Legion Handbook in the 80s. People could bring them aside, and I go, I drew the Legion! Oh my God! I'm forgetting stuff. So, like, it's crazy. But anyway, so I got into comics and got work from Marvel in DC, was lucky at, 18 years old, got a book called Hawk and Dove. Once again, and I'm proud to say it, I was the last guy to be chosen. Because I had friends who were like, I'm not doing that Hawk and Dove book. Yeah, I got offered that. It sucks. And I'm like, I want Hawk and Dove. Because I was a Teen Titans fan too. And I knew they would make a Dove a female. And I'm like, that's the best thing they can do, because male Dove was horrible. Male Dove would be like, oh, what are you doing? Don't do that. I'm peaceful. A peaceful character doesn't work. Dove kicking your ass works. And I was like, I want to be that guy. I read the Kiesels. Carl Kiesel and Barbara Kiesel had a proposal at San Diego, and I followed them around. Please let me do this. Please. We'll get back to you. We'll get back to you. And like I said, my last friend, his name was Art Tabert. He's a brilliant inker. He inks for Marvel, DC Comics. We laugh about it all the time. He goes, Rob, I'm taking this other miniseries called Challengers of the Unknown. I turned them down. And I like sat by the phone. They're calling me. I'm the last guy. Everyone's turned around. Everyone good's turned them down. I'm going to get this. And sure enough, ring.
Kleinfeld, one behind him.
Done! So I didn't talk it up. And the great thing was, and it was brutal, it was my first monthly book. They all came out on time, wonderful, lovely, but I didn't know that anybody liked my work. Because my editor and I hated each other, still do. And he was temperamental. I mean, he treated people like the way I treat people is opposite how he was a crazy person. Mike Carlin, I'll say your name out loud. You were a jerk. Called me one time, screaming at me, and I'm like, the book's done. Like, I'm done. Like, the fifth issue is in. And he was like, you pulled this crap while I was on the set of Superboy. Do you guys remember the Superboy show? It was in the late 80s. They shot it somewhere in Florida.
Yeah.
People forget this thing. Well, he wanted to be in Hollywood so bad, he started leaving for months on end and would go to the set. And he'd leave his assistant editor. So we worked it all out. So I'd already gone. Because while I was on Hawking Dove, Marvel called me. And they said, Rob, we want you to come and work in the Xbox. In the X office. Now, if I could, for dramatic purposes, drop this mic right now, boom, because it's expensive and I would have to buy it and I'm not going to do that. But I was like, the X-Men office. People, see, we are in this brand new Disney-fied world where the Avengers is everything to mankind. Tony Stark and Cat, because it's Chris Evans and Downey Jr. and Hemsworth. But when I was a kid, the X-Men, not when I was a kid, the industry was all about the X-Men. Those were the books that the best people wrote. Chris Claremont wrote the best stuff. He worked with the best artists, and those books were at the top of the charts. Except for the New Mutants. And they said, Rob? And I hugged Bob McLeod today. I met him for the first time, loved him. I was on board as a kid. I bought New Mutants number one. I bought New Mutants, all of them. But there was a period, like anybody, that the book had gotten stagnant. And I didn't believe that. Marvel believed that. They said, Rob, we're cleaning house. I'm putting new artists on everybody. You want X Factor? And I said, no. And literally, Bob Harris said, Rob, I just offered you X Factor. It's the second best selling X Men book. I said, no, that would be a terrible move for me. I will be following Walt Simonson. He is a god. I will be not seen as a god. So I don't need that to start my career. I'm very young in my career. And they said, well, we got New Mutants, and we're going to change that. But honestly, Rob, we're probably going to cancel it. And I said, get down. Fixer Upper? I want the Fixer Upper. Like, I can do anything? And they're like, Rob, you can do anything. And I said, can I introduce a new leader named Cable? And they said, yes. And I even won my first showdown. And like, I love Louis Simonson, she's great. But there was no way Cable was gonna be called Commander X, okay? I was like, this is G.I. Joe. So I pulled Cable back. I said, I will not give you Cable, Marvel, because this is how, so I knew New Mutants needed a facelift. It didn't need new carpet. It needed new walls, new chandeliers, lights, the whole thing. Now, my house is being renovated right now. Not because I'm rich, because the pipe burst and the insurance company is paying for it. I know what it's like. I delayed moving out of my office for days, and my contractor will tell you we had to strap Rob to a table and carry him out of a gurney to get to his office so we could destroy it because we had to do the floors. Anyway, New Mutants needed a complete renovation. It was 1989, and everyone still looked like it was 1983. Go look at the book. Boom, boom, look like Madonna with a giant bow. People haven't worn a bow in 6 years. Boom, Madonna stopped wearing the bow like with Lucky Star. And I was in high school, so I know, like, that's 83. It's 89. Why is she still wearing suspenders and a bow? And why does Richter look like Billy Idol? The Rebel Yell was big in 83. Like, this book was caught in a time loop. So I'm like, you're not, no way. I said, Bob, I said, his name's Cable or it's nothing. And then I remember, right before I went to press, Rob, can we call him Quinn? I'm out! No Quinn! No Commander X! Gotta be Cable. And they said, all right, we'll leave you Cable. And I said, here's who he is. He's come from the future. Blah, 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 blah. And they went, yes, 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 yes. And I'm like, this is exciting. And so we went from a book that was about to be canceled to a book that suddenly took off. And look, I was working my butt off drawing that book. Because I knew I'm up against, this is what people don't understand. And in any business, my kids were in sports. They're all in soccer and basketball. We watch sports and we watch, you know, even what we'll get to when we get to Deadpool movie, competition. Look at this summer. Marvel film fans against DC film fans. You said you didn't like the Suicide Squad? The DC bros came after you. Death to you, Lightbulb. I'm out. I just go down the hole. I'll come back out with you. Because man, the competition is crazy. Well, I was up against a guy named Todd McFarlane, who was going to make Spider-Man the number one book, and he would tell everybody. And I would talk to Todd. And talking to Todd is like attending this panel where I don't let you talk, I just talk. But he talks for 2 hours straight. Eric Larson and I met Todd McFarlane at San Diego Comic-Con in 1989. And he went, oh, the Hellboys. Oh, and Todd talks to him. Larson, Liefeld, Lim, and Lee. The Cowboys. And I'm like, okay, it's not a point. We all broke in at the same time. Larson, Lee, Ron Lim, and Jim Lee. Like, oh, no, no. Jim Lee, Rob Liefeld, Eric Larson, Ron Lim. The Elbows. Okay, fine. And he would say, oh, you guys, you're like taunts. I'd be in the elevator. He goes,
you're drawing a team book. You're drawing them six characters with hair and eyeballs and stubble and clothes. And I'm drawing Spider-Man, a big oval, and big oval eyes. I'm done. And he goes, I'm drawing backgrounds while you're drawing kids in diapers. And I'm like, the greatest taunter that ever lived. Muhammad Ali had nothing on top of him. If he wanted to get in your head, he would get in your head. And so he's going, why are you going to the X office? You should be with me on the Spider-Man. Me and Larson, Spider-Man office. We're turning around. I'm like, I don't like Spider-Man. I like the X-Men. I'm like, I'm going to get to Wolverine somehow. And somebody asked me today, and I think they were shocked how fast. The guy in line said, hey, can I ask you, who's your favorite character? Wolverine. It was like that. Wolverine. He looked awesome. He was awesome. His mystery that they, you know, created around him. There's no Cable or Deadpool without Wolverine. He was my holy grail. I wanted to be in the Wolverine business, or at least create the next Wolverine. And so then you got Jim Lee coming in on the X-Men. So Todd had Spider-Man, worldwide icon, best-selling Marvel. Jim had the X-Men, best-selling comic of all time. Rob has the New Mutants. How are you going to equal up that game? How are you going to make that a fair fight? Because I gotta get sales. We are Tom Greenberg from Marvel today tweeted out, never forget Marvel exists to turn a profit on comic books. Sorry, that's the truth. I retweeted it. It's a truth in publishing. That's the truth. If you're not buying the Legion of Superheroes, they don't exist. I currently haven't had a Legion of Superheroes book in 5 years because they don't publish it because we didn't all buy enough copies. That's just reality. Movies don't get sequels because people didn't buy enough tickets. So the New Mutants, the clock was on. How do I turn this baby around? Well, after 10 issues, we had sold a lot of copies. I am proud to tell you that by New Mutants, like 92, 94, they're like, Rob, we're doing 500,000. We went from 100,000 with my first issue, which is a great number today, but the X-Men books were all selling in the 400,000. So the New Mutants really was like on the clock. There was X-Factor, Wolverine, and X-Men, all doing great. And X-Men, they had gone to double shipping. If you were in the 80s and late 80s, they would bi-weekly. So you're like, oh my gosh, they're just, you know, what DC's doing now, bi-weekly. So they finally said, Rob, we are going to commit to you full-time. We like your vibes. We like your energy. We're going to let you have the whole New Mutants job. And I was like, oh! And the competitive edge was like, now I've got to prove myself. And I tell people, there's a reason my first issue that I actually wrote the book, I created a story. It's called The Plot, the characters, the interaction, everything. I did it all from my studio in Fullerton, California. There's a reason Domino, Deadpool, and Gideon all appeared in the very first issue. I'm like, someone just lost their job. I've now been input in that position by my bosses. If I don't perform, guess who's losing his job? That's me right here. And any comic artist will tell you, you gotta pay the bills. You're always working for your next job. We're not sitting there fat and happy. The minute you get one sale, you go, are my sales gonna drop next week? I have three friends in my time that they run network television. They are miserable. A show debuts, my show only debuts to 7 million. Next week it's gonna be down to 4. I'll never cancel it. It's miserable. And then you've got my buddy Robert Kirkman. Who I say, Kirkman, your ratings are going up. I think we've done as good as we can. I'm doing a total terrible Robert Kirkman. I said, no, Negan is going to turn around, bro, just like in the comics. Calls me Monday morning. Biggest numbers we've had in 5 years. Boom. Like, the master of all television, my buddy Robert Kirkman. But networks, comic books, exist on the same thing. So New Mutants 98, I put it all in the book. Needed a new guy to redefine the team, Deadpool. Needed a girl of mystery, Domino. Needed a guy who was supposed to be bigger than he was, sorry, Gideon. I have a lot to say about New Mutants 98, 2 out of 3 8-battle. I'll take those ads every time. They're odds every single time. So Domino and Deadpool, still awesome. Gideon, gone. But so New Mutants 98 sold like 750,000. Rob, you're hung up on sales. I am. Those were good royalties. I had a dad, people don't know this, my dad suffered from brain tumors, multiple brain tumors, since I was in sixth grade. He was in a coma my entire sixth grade year, blood clot. So I had a mom, God bless her, who was crying all the time because she didn't know if her husband was going to get out of the hospital, and I was numb.
Like, my sister's 7 years older than me, gone all the time, and I was sitting there going, what's going to happen to our wife? My dad is in a hospital room, and they won't let me see him because he's black and blue because of the blood clot. So I dove into comic books. I dove into drawing. That was my therapy. It's part of my love affair with comics. So when you read about the Deadpool and the cancer stuff, that is from the Rob Liefeld storybook, and was the reason he went to, you know, the Weapon X program and got juiced and became the freak that we all know and love today. But so that book selling so well, I said, can we not name this the New Mutants anymore? Since there's no New Mutants anymore, I pushed them all out. And they're like, Rob, we'll take a flyer on you. We'll do X-Force. Again, my favorite conversation. Todd McFarlane, my buddy, my mentor, the best coach in comics. What do you think X-Force is going to sell? A million? Maybe? But he had just sold 3 million Spider-Man. Okay. He's like, well, Jimmy's got X-Men coming out. He's going to do a lot. Rob, what's an X-Force? What's a Deadpool? No one knows this. And I'm like, okay, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. I'm going to believe myself. We're gonna do better than a million. Todd doesn't want me to outsell him. Again, competitiveness. It's LeBron and Dwayne and Kobe on the basketball court. They all want to outscore each other and have the records. And that was the Image 7. We all loved each other and simultaneously hated each other. And if they deny it, they're lying. I was there. I was in those elevators. I was in those boardrooms. I was there. And it's amazing that we started in these comments because we were a bunch of crazy people. And we were young. And I told somebody today, somebody that young blood, and they're talking to me, Image Comics is 25 years old this year. It is a great accomplishment. I'm going to invoke my buddy, Robert Kirkman, again, who, I don't know if you guys know, I shared it on social media. Robert Kirkman is a dear, he's so ridiculously successful, and he should be, a goal for all of us in how to never give up and, really go against the odds, because someday there'll be a book about how The Walking Dead got actually to the television screen. And the hurdles he had to overcome, and then now the rewards that he gets, and I'm not talking financial awards, just the awards to do anything you want. He has creative freedom. And that's what every artist wants too. They want creative freedom. And Robert called me about 3 weeks after the Deadpool movie came out. He said, hey, can I come by on Saturday? I'm like, it's Saturday. Why do you want to come visit me? He lives in LA, I live in Orange County. It's about an hour drive. He said, yeah, I'm going to come by. I don't want to tell you why. I just want to come by. And then, so he says, I'll be there at 10 o'clock. On Saturday morning, so I'm looking up Kirk, Robert here, because I'm already thinking, where are we going to eat burgers? Where are we going to go to 3 week comics? We're geeks. I'm like, kind of a Saturday with Robert is like, I'm back in the sixth grade. We're like, hooked. Like, it's all awesome. Like, we're going to both be away from our families all day and do comic book. Crazy stuff. I think we fit a movie into. But his son and he get out of the car, and they have these giant, like, his son is carrying a giant package, and Robert's carrying it, and I don't know if I showed it on Instagram and social media. He got me a 6-foot Deadpool statue that he ordered from China. And I'm like, who orders this Deadpool statue from China? And he gives it to me. I said to him, I will officially never out gift you. This is, you can call, like, scoreboard. You win. I'm not buying you something. Not liking it. But anyway, Image Comics, so then he takes me out and he says, man, I just want to tell you, thanks for starting Image Comics. His son is a giant Deadpool fan. He said, his son wanted to know about Deadpool and wanted to know about me, and then he said, son, and then Mr. Liefeld left and started Image Comics, and if there was no Image Comics, I'm not doing The Walking Dead. And that's a fact. And he goes, I'm just making my way through all the owners and telling them how much I appreciate each and every one of you. I gotta be honest, I didn't make Robert uncomfortable because you can't say that to me because I'll start crying and I kind of got welled up and I kind of got teary. And he was like, oh wow, I didn't know this made you cry. I'm sentimental. My kids won't talk to me. So here's the deal. So after we start launching X-Force and sold 5 million copies, I tell you this because there's a lot of kids who don't know this. And you know what? The history books, they used to make a lot more comic book history books than they do now. Now, pop figures, they make pop figures. I was in the comic store the other day, and Rob, we're clearing out this whole shelf. We're putting more pop figures in. I love pop figures. This is not a diss against pop figures. I have tons of pop figures. So it's not a diss, it's just the reality. The history of comics has not always been told correctly, and as long as I'm alive, I'm gonna tell it the way I lived it and the way it was. And pretty much no one has ever challenged me, because the comic book history books that do exist reflect what I say, and I tell it like it is, I tell it straight. We left and we formed Image Comics, and this is where I'm about to segue, and I'm not going to cover any more time, this is the essential stuff. And Image Comics launched, and in August, of 1992, we were the number two company. The number two company. We beat DC Comics, who had 60 comics. And we had eight, if anyone's wondering. We published eight comics and beat the DC behemoth, who publishes Superman and Batman and the Justice League. And that was the shock heard around the world. If you want to ask me, like, one of my favorite moments in comics was when we all got that report that came through. Now, kids out there, there's a thing called a fax machine. And you go, and then about a quarter of an inch is coming up. Eventually, the whole shit comes out after 5 minutes, and it's in. Market share. Image Comics, number two company. What? We'd only been in business 4 months. So that was a lot of fun. And that's the thing. The Image guys and I, we had a ton of fun. We wrecked a lot of models of this industry. We opened a lot of doors. Here's the deal. I was originally coming to this show on Saturday and Sunday. Because I don't want anyone to think that I'm going to LA to do Stan Lee's Kamikaze because I tried to jigger two shows. I love Stan Lee's Kamikaze. They've always been really good to me. But the people who run the show called and said, Rob, we want to put you on Friday and Saturday instead. Would you do that? And I said, yeah, sure, I'll do whatever you want. You're the boss. They said, good, because David Tennant is coming on Sunday, and he's going to dominate the whole day. So we figured if we moved you to Friday and Saturday, better. So great. So I called him, Kamikaze, I'll be there. The reason I'm telling you about this is almost all the guys I work with at my Extreme Studios have now grown up. They're animators. They're designing movies for Marvel. They're ad people. They're directors. And they're all going to be there. And I love seeing them. We have great memories of over 60 artists I employed. And that was one of my proudest moments. But anyway, when's he going to talk about Deadpool? So, in 2009, we all saw that very interesting movie called Wolverine. I sat there with my family, sinking and sinking and sinking, and going, that's not Deadpool. And you know what? They knew that it wasn't Deadpool. And I'll tell you, if there's ever been a company that acted fast, the producers knew they let everybody down. They called me up. They said, Rob, come meet with us. We want to talk to you about what we can do. We sat there. We talked story. I was there for 3 hours. No to this. No to that. That's horrible. Stay away from that. You've done horrible. Do this thing. Because I said, I know what the fans want to see. I'm here. I'm with the fans. They talk to me. I know, and I also know what sells. I know what the people like. And so I sat with Lauren Stewart, Donner, and her team, and we just kind of shot around ideas. And some of it, you know, you've already seen online, but I was like they were like, well, Rob, who should be his girlfriend? And should we have Cable? And all this stuff. And I was like, no, come on, man. Ryan Reynolds, in that 6 minutes that he kicked ass in Wolverine Origins, and I'm talking in the first 20 minutes, he deserves his own showcase. And I hate when the movies, they dump too much on them. They try and explain too much. Like, just keep it lean. Make it about Deadpool. Make it about Wade. So I didn't know if they'd listen to me. I was just in there to consult. And, they hired two of the best writers on the face of the planet, Rick Reiss, Paul Wernick. And my wife and I, she's not a zombie person. She's not a horror person. I talked to her to see Zombieland, and it was one of the best movies we saw that year, and we couldn't stop talking about it. And when I saw that they got Paul and Rick, I was like, oh my gosh, Deadpool has suddenly got some juice. And then, as we well know, a gentleman named Tom Rothman put the brakes on for 5 years. Total psychopath. Did not believe on any level that Deadpool would work as a movie, and didn't bother telling anyone. I was there when Tim Miller said, Rob, we've got money to make this short film. I get to do a proof of concept. I drove up to Blur Studios. Blur Studios is my new Disneyland. It's like the LA version of George Lucas's ILM when, in the 80s, ILM was the big special effects house. And Tim Miller is a genius. And so I would go and I watched all the storyboards he created, and I was there the day Ryan and them, all the guys shot the footage that leaked that launched Deadpool into a film. But that was in 2010. And it got to the point where I'd be like, hey Tim, can I come up and watch that short in your theater? And he's like, lights are always on for you, Rob, come on down. And I'd bring Kirkman. Or one time I brought Gina Carano. That's a funny story. Tim goes, I hear you're doing a movie with Gina Carano. Can you introduce me to her? I said, yeah, let's do it. Came down, Gina, watch it. Oh my gosh, I've got to work with you. Cut to Gina is in Deadpool. Awesome. The thing is, Tim, I'm a connector. That worked out very fortuitously for everybody. But so that footage just hung around, and I would watch it. And Tim even sent me a little, high-res version that I could just,
watch, and no, I didn't leak that footage, but the thing is, it was like, when is this ever going to get made? And then I remember coming home from San Diego. San Diego was one of my favorite times of the year. That convention kicks all sorts of ass. It's the best time you're ever going to have at Comic-Con. But Sunday, driving home was always a little sad. You get there on a Wednesday, and you leave at Sunday around 6 o'clock, unless you have dinner with your friends, or 8 o'clock, whatever. But generally, I live an hour and a half away, so I'm pulling in at 10 o'clock, and I'm tired. My family already left early in the day, because my kids love San Diego. And I drive back separately with a buddy, dropped him off, got in, dropped my bags, turned on, I was going to watch Game of Thrones, or whatever was on HBO, it was 10 o'clock, and then I get all these alerts. And I'm like, what's going on? Crap, the footage leaked! I was like, this is gonna be awesome! And it was awesome. And thank you for downloading it and watching it 25 million times. Because you guys made that Deadpool movie happen. Here we go. You know, 6 weeks later, because Rick Reese texted me and said, Rob, the footage is out! And I was like, this is the best thing. People deserve to see that footage. But then you sit back and you go, well, what are they going to think? And again, the internet went, this is better than any announcement in San Diego. So whoever leaked that was very smart. They waited until everybody showed their stuff, because in San Diego, it's like, you know, the home shopping network for movies. I brought my beautiful movie. Don't you see? And we brought Benedict Cumberbatch. And I can share with them. And I brought the entire cast of the Avengers. Don't you love them? Write about that on the internet. I mean, San Diego is a showcase for, look what I got. Look what I got. And I'm in college. I'm guilty. I'm there too going, oh, it's not the Avengers. Never in my lifetime. I mean, my son was like, I don't know that I've ever seen Dad like this, and I don't know that I've ever seen him. I was there stopping. Robert, Dad, you gotta love you. So, but pretty great timing to drive all the way home. San Diego's done. Everyone's kind of done. There wasn't a clear winner in 2014. And then suddenly, oh, hi, this kick-ass Deadpool short film is online, and why don't you watch it as much as you like? And somehow it went from a low-res version to a high-res version. And you knew that Fox didn't mind because they didn't pull it down. And you're like, it's staying up. And look, it did get the movie made. So, cut to my wife and I flying to Vancouver to be on the set, and I couldn't believe I was in that bar, and I couldn't believe there all the crap was happening. There's Ryan as Deadpool, and all crap. And that movie was, I knew it was phenomenal. But I'm going to tell you a fun story because Rhett Reese and I talk about basketball a lot. He's a huge basketball guy, college and pros. So, we're talking about, you know, basketball in between takes out in the tent, and then I said, Red, everything I've seen here today, I'm going to tell you this movie's going to open really well. And this is March of 2015, so they're shooting. And I said, and he looks at me like, because people, when you're shooting a movie, you don't want to hear good stuff about it. That's like a jinx. Well, Blankfield isn't bright enough to care. I'm just all emotion. I just touched my character, and I touched his sword, and I hung out in the bar, and Deadpool said hi to me, and what the hell am I doing? But I said, Red, this movie's like Ted. And he's like, what? And I'm like, Ted was a foul-mouthed Wilton Bear. And my wife and I had to wait in a long line. He didn't see it that weekend. And Ted opened to $60-some million. I said, Deadpool's opening at $65 million. Oh, Lightbulb, shut up! No, Lightbulb, shut your mouth. I was like, he's dumping right on there. Toby, heal! And I was like, I'm sorry I jinxed the show. Oh, we don't want to hear that. Because again, they've been 6 years of trying to move this ball uphill. And now they're here and they're doing it. And so then the nerves are settling in. Like, is this really, after the studio gave us the clearance, is this going to work? And so anyway, on the opening weekend, when I think it made $60 million the first day, I said, yeah, I was way off. You were right. I was wrong. And Fox was great. They were sending me the call. They can do these crazy things. I'm in my hotel, and my buddy from Fox sends me, hey, Rob, you're going to do $153 million this weekend. I'm like, no. But he gets it. And I'm like, $153 on a $58 million budget? Whoa! And that was just awesome. That was just a fun time. And, you know, my kid, he wanted to go see with all his other buddies. And they're all 16. And
They couldn't get in to see it. They're smart kids and they know how to get in to see it. So he drove them there, knowingly. Where's the promises? And I drive up the hill to the theater near our house, and I'm like, holy crap, Julie, my wife. There's that line out the door. That's getting crap. This movie's caught on. And then my son comes home, and I go, man, how was it? So did you like it? Because my son went to one of the screenings, and he didn't like sitting next to me. And he told me, I was embarrassed to be there with you, Dad. It's weird, it's weird. So he's 15 at the time. Yeah, he was 15, not 16. Sorry, he turned 16 in May. Why am I telling you this? Because he comes home, and he gives me the poison pill. Dad, we loved it. I'm so happy that you loved it. All my friends loved it, Dad. We're going to see it multiple times. But there's one thing, Dad. We couldn't get in, so we bought tickets to Zoolander 2 instead. And I said, you what? And you made $100. I mean, like, my kids are big. But I said, you will never give another movie. That's bad. Fox wants that $30 for them, not for him. And so he did it legit. I would walk him in the next time, and walk him out. Like, my parents never did for me. People forget, man. Like, a couple people mentioned to me this weekend how they loved the R-rated. Of course you did. And then when people go, Deadpool didn't succeed because it was R-rated. Are you kidding me? You don't get that gunshot through the head. Boom, 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 boom. Yeah. And they're like, I love blood. And the raunch humor without R. When I grew up, every Schwarzenegger, every Stallone, Von Damme, Bruce Willis movie was R. People forget all the diehards are R-rated movies. Lethal Weapons, R-rated movies. Predator, R-rated movie. Rambo, First Blood, are you kidding me? Those are R-rated movies. I didn't have kids. Now everything's been Disney-fied. Let's get all the kids in. Those kids reading right now, they want them in the theater. We want you with a bucket of popcorn watching Doctor Strange. PG-13. I'm like, so Deadpool really had a huge risk. And it is the credit of theirs that they did so well. And I am so proud and happy for Tim and Ryan and Rhett and Paul and Simon and all the guys. And they deserve that. They made a killer, 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 killer film that they own and they belong, that belongs to them. And I'll tell you what, I also, because my kids are awesome. They unveil like the mysteries of the world with me by saying stuff like this. Dad, where can I see that freeway scene? That freeway scene is awesome. Can I see that in the comic? You cannot. That is a product of Rhett, Paul, and Ryan, and Tim. Okay. Hey, Dad. What did that last fight on the helicarrier? It's not supposed to be a helicarrier. where's that? I want to read about that in the comic. Can I read about it? Yeah, that doesn't exist. That's for the movie. They made that for the movie. That was their own original take and idea. Okay. Well, Dad, here's the other thing. What about Negasonic and Colossus teaming up with Deadpool? Never happened, son. That's them. That's these brilliant filmmakers. I'm telling you, Deadpool, the movie, is my favorite Deadpool because they just put together the best story ever. And now, that's not to say, because I'm going to segue here, Deadpool is not a movie. We're going to get a movie. We got this movie, and this movie was great. And maybe we'll get another one. And it'll be great. I'm hoping. I know that Fox, it is their priority. You don't make a movie for $15 million that makes $800 million and not put everything into making a great sequel. And they will. And they have every reason and every initiative to do that. And they are. And it's going to be great. And if you told me that Warner Brothers, this has nothing to do with the quality of the movie, would put a historic Superman and Batman and Wonder Woman and a fantastic version of Wonder Woman, I made it, and a great version of Batman, if they would put them all in a movie together, I didn't like the movie personally, but I liked the characters. And it would not make as much as Deadpool. I would have lost that bet. I'm like, you mean this historic, all these icons and little R-rated Deadpool? Basically like, Superman and Batman and Wonder Woman teamed up in the United States. I need to, before the DC bros come out, throw boulders on my head. In the United States of America, they were 30 million shy of them. Okay, they got to go to China and make more international. But in the United States, Superman, he's apple pie and Americana, lost a big old DP. You know, had weird sex with that girl in a great montage. I said that. Think of Calendar Girl again in the same way. I'm like, is he eating cake out of her? Anyway, so here's the deal. Deadpool's in great shape. Obviously, Marvel knows this because they give you Deadpool every day, it seems, and it's awesome, and I love it. And I love seeing all the new Deadpool stuff, and I'm always, somehow, I'm doing a cover, or I'm doing something. I have a Deadpool graphic novel, 100 pages, coming out in February or March. I think it's February. It might be March. I think it's February. It's with the guys who do X-Men 92, Chad Powers and Chris Sims. It is the best thing I've ever done. It will. We made it for an audience that likes the comic and the movie, and I really think you're going to, Domino's in it, Cable's in it, X-Force is in it. It takes place in the past and present, and it deals with a character that I've introduced that followed Wade into the program, who we're going to meet Wade as a kid. And this kid who looked up to him and who followed him wanted to be Wade Wilson. And I won't tell you anymore, but it's a fantastic, it's a blast. Please pick it up, please check it out. Like I said, Deadpool is a movement. I didn't make Deadpool for Fox Studios. As you know, we'll go back to the beginning of this. I made it for Marvel Comics. I wanted Deadpool to interact with Marvel Comics and Cable to interact with Marvel Comics. And, you know, so when you buy your pops or your t-shirts or all that crap, you're part of the movement. And I see all these awesome cosplayers that I've met. You're awesome. Have you guys seen the X-Force cosplayers? I have never seen better cosplay in my life. And all you Deadpools are awesome. But I mean, some of the level of this tech is going up to an insane amount. But Deadpool is, it's awesome when you see something that you drew and you created and it comes to life and it becomes 3D. And it's walking around you in awesome cosplay, and it's a pop figure or 100 pop figures, because I don't even have them all. I've lost track. There's one with the chef hat. What? The thing is, it's amazing. But I mean, kids who have never seen the Deadpool movie come up to me and say, "I love Deadpool. He's my favorite." Did you see the movie? And their parents are like, "No." Sorry. I didn't go for a bad parent. I'll try that. My youngest kid didn't see it. I'm a good parent. That's not true. They didn't see it. That's true. I'm not the parent part of that question. But anyway, I think I had some stuff to get off my chest. I did that. If you have any questions you want to ask me, let's end it with some questions. I will come to you. I will come to you. I will not come to you, dog. I don't want you to hurt me. No, I have a beautiful dog. He's totally sleeping, and I don't want to bug him. I have a dog, and I love when he sleeps. Okay, you right there. That was not a diss on you, dog. You're awesome.
You're not having any input on who they're picking for Cable.
Here's the deal. They don't input on what I put on the page, and it would be, okay, I would be such a jerk if I called them. Hey man, can I wait? Now, did I get some messages from Tim Miller saying you're going to love this guy, you're going to hate this guy, and you got to live with this? And I'd be like, okay, but Tim, as we know, sadly, Tim Miller is a genius. He's my buddy, and the one thing I do want to hit on, some rumors came out this week that said that he had a falling out with the studio over the budget being 3 times. That is 100% not true. I sat with Tim in April at his Blur Studios that I told you I love to live there and hang out there, and he was talking about the sequel with me, and he told me about the budget, and it was minuscule because Tim didn't want to have the pressure of having a bigger budget. When you have a bigger budget, I use it against people. I use it like, you spent $225 million on that? You know, I'm that snarky guy. I'm human. So he was like, "All right, it's gonna be great. We got a little more money. We can do this. But you know, we can do all these great things." His Blur Studio is amazing. The tricks that they do are fantastic. Enthusiasm. He wasn't like, "Oh, gee, shucks, they didn't give me that." He was like, "We got a little more. And we're gonna make that work, and it's gonna be great." Because the first movie, Tim's Aware, was beautiful because it wasn't bloated. You know, and look, Colossus wasn't cheap. You take part of that budget. When Tim invited me to a screening, I went to a test screening in December. And I can say this now, if they hate me forever, whatever. It got a 92 from the audience. And that is unheard of in the movie business. And that's when I knew we got something special here. And Colossus, I think Tim was like, "Are you going to tell me that, Deadpool?" Because again, I'm an X-Men fan. So after the theater, I was like, "And Colossus! And then with Colossus! And Colossus! And oh my gosh, it's the best Colossus!" And he's like, okay, I'm glad you like Colossus. Whatever it is. But Colossus looked so great because they really took their time making it look great, you know? But like I said, are you kidding me? Deadpool is a priority for Fox. And Ryan Reynolds is Deadpool. I mean, he is Deadpool. I stood right next to him and been like, "Is he gonna slap me?" And shoot and pull my pants down. He is Deadpool. He is so witty and funny and amazingly physical. You know, all that torture scene in the workshop in the movie, I mean, That wasn't a stunt double. He had his shirt off. He was cold. They dipped him in freezing ice water multiple takes. That's hard. And he still looked rippling and awesome. My wife, there he goes again with this guy. Kind of like some guys. But, Kobe, Ryan, McConaughey, Tom Cruise, the list is long. But the thing is that movie is top priority for them. And Ryan Reynolds won Clio's last week. I don't know if you know this, but I mean, when he did that viral marketing, the Halloween one, I had to literally drive off the street because I was a bad person. I was watching it as I drove. And I went, okay, you're gonna kill yourself, Michael. Pull over like a responsible person and park it. When he was like recruiting the X-Men on the swing set, okay, I have gathered you all. That's pure him. He thinks of that stuff at his house and just goes out and shoots it. And I mean, he is brilliant. So Ryan is not gonna let the Deadpool sequel be anything but outstanding. Trust me, take that to the bank and get excited. You know, I mean, that they're gonna do some great stuff and it's gonna broaden a whole other world for, I think, that wing of the X-Men. So, I don't know what you asked me, hopefully I answered. You're right here, kid, I love kids. Am I anxious for another game? Oh, they need to make 10 more games. Are you kidding me? We burned through that. Okay, not we. My kids are also really good gamers. I am horrible. The last game I played was GoldenEye.
Oh, wow.
And my wife was like, are you ever coming back to us? Because I was like, I'm going to turn the corner, and I'm going to shoot people. That was a first-person shooter, crazy person. But my kids are awesome gamers, like all of you kids are, millennials and younger. And so I would say, okay, true story, I've told this before, but the night the Deadpool came out, I took my kids to Taco Tuesday, my wife was out doing something fun, then I took the kids to Taco Tuesday, and then we after Taco Tuesday, there's a GameStop, and I went to the GameStop. I said, I would like one Deadpool game, sir. And he said, that game's been a lot of problems for us today. And I go, I would like one Deadpool game. Like, I need to go. Can you just give me the game? I'm here to give you $65 for a game. Don't you want it? And he's like, I have to tell you, this game is very R-rated, very cursing, and there's blood. I said, can I please have a Deadpool game? And they're like, we're going to talk to the manager. And I finally said, I'm a Deadpool. Just give me my game about my character. And the guy just did not. I said, Google me right now as I'm done. I'm buying this from the other GameStop. It's not worried about it. Do I look like a worried mother? I want my game. So they gave me the game, and I tore open the present, and I handed it to my 12-year-old son. Play this. And he's like, I have been engaged by my father to play the X-rated game. And we're good Christians, by the way. But, so about the third level, after they met Deadpool, and if you played it, there was a welcoming song for Deadpool that was very vulgar and made me laugh. You can Google it, it's on YouTube. And but when Deadpool, at the end of the game, because we let our kids be violent, but we don't let them get turned on. That's a society, right? I'm not talking about the Lightbulb family. But when Deadpool starts reaching through the girl's boobs, I think at the end of the third level, I went, okay, won't be able to explain this to mom. Click. Am I done, Dad? You're done. Thank you, Luke. And then I went over to another buddy's house, and he played the rest of the game for me. But I just sat there and watched it, because I can't play games. But yes, they should do another game. And that game was ahead of its time. You know that when it came out, because of all those mommy, because here's the deal. This is the greatness of Deadpool. This is why Deadpool's a movement. But I have a nephew. We're fishing. Cable, what's up? Hey, Uncle Rob, I just want to tell you I love Cable. Cool, that's awesome. What do you like about Cable? It was 3 years ago. I love Cable I love Deadpool classics. I love Deadpool meets Moby Dick. And I was like, okay, I need to accept that. That he loves Deadpool in a certain form. Because they did a whole Deadpool classics illustrated Moby Dick, William Tell. And see, that kid then goes and buys the pop figure because he's so cute and cuddly. It's Deadpool, he's cute. And he's funny! And then in this video game, he's raping and shooting people! But he's a vicious, murdering person! And I'll never forget the lady that was, I was at a Las Vegas con, and she came up to me and she started scolding me. And her kid was adorable. He was head to toe, Deadpool. Had the swords. I said, hi, Hina! You love the machine! And then I said, he goes, but I can't see the movie when it comes out because it's R. And the mom goes, I can't believe you people would do that. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I've never heard of Deadpool before Billy dressed up. And I said, I understand, ma'am. It's awfully hard when your son dresses up as a murdering mercenary. You can't go see that movie. And she's like, why? It was the best why I ever had. He's not a superhero. He doesn't save people. This isn't Superman. He doesn't, you know, tell Ma Kent. I'm going to save that city, except the new Superman lets everyone die, which is awesome. But this is funny. It's like, all these little kids are mercenaries. Like, hey, you little murdering assassin. You know? But I guess in some version of your parents' world, you're saving the bus from going over the bridge. No, he let that happen and take a picture. I hope I answered your question. I think they should make a lot more. I wouldn't be surprised. That video game was reissued because of the movie and sold terrifically. I think I'm probably getting kicked out soon. Yes, you're right there.
Are you excited for the Logan movie?
Are you kidding me, Mike? Okay, I always go to my kids if they know me most. I sit home all day and I draw. So I'm a weird stay-at-home check-in dad. And so before the office, I'm like, kids, gather around! And my one son, Chase, is like, damn, he's such a freak. And my son, he's got my DNA. He's like, okay, and we're going to watch the Logan trailer! And we watched it like 10 times. And I got choked up every time. And I'm so ready for Hugh Jackman to stick those claws in a pool and pull out and have blood on them this time. Wow! That was the first time. He put his claws into your organs and moved them around and they didn't come out clean. I'm so excited! That's my mutant power. My mutant power is that I can clean the blades on their way out to Mexico. So yeah, no, Logan looks outstanding. It's going to take me through the year. You have a question.
So first off, thank you. I've been reading the comics behind my parents' backs since I was 9.
I love it. And he's not a superhero. Are we in agreement?
Yeah,
there you go. He likes to hang out with Spider-Man.
And I've got a dog named Deadpool, who's awesome.
Not
this one.
Oh, I love
it. Is Deadpool actually pansexual? Sometimes it seems like it's
Ryan says yes. Ryan is Deadpool. Done. When I signed my contract with this Deadpool guy, well, that's why I'm going to say it. When I say Deadpool, I mean, this is the best response Marvel can give me. I said, well, guys, I want to tell you about the movie. Well, again, Marvel is owned by Disney. They don't have anything to do Fox, right? And I'm kind of this guy who lives in both worlds. I love all my Fox friends, and I love all my Marvel friends, even when they don't get along. But when I said to the president of Marvel, I said, you're going to love Deadpool. This is August of 2015, so Deadpool 6 months or more away. I said, you're going to love Deadpool. You're going to love it. It's so good. And he goes, Rob, because again, the corporate means that's how they speak. They don't speak like me. I will never be a corporate guy and be fired. Like me. So, Rob, whatever Deadpool's success as a film or not, I promise you, Deadpool has a bright future in Marvel publishing. And I'm like, that's right. I've been passing those checks for 25 years, so I know that. Vote, show. So. So that's why it's like, okay, you know, next movie, 2018, can't get here fast enough, let's do that. In the meantime, great comics by Marvel. I'm so happy to have met guys like Cullen Bunn and all these other amazing talents that make the Deadpool comics. And I get to draw covers for. And these guys are, I mean, they're creating great stories. When they call me, hey Rob, we're putting Venom on Deadpool. And would you like to do the cover? Done! Like, best cover I'll ever draw for you, and it was. I'm like, Deadpool Back in Black, done. I'll have it done tomorrow. Like, that's awesome. Great high concept stuff. Marvel, you know, they get it. They just get it. They're great with Deadpool. And again, their licensing is great. Deadpool pops. I walk through Target. There's Deadpool belts and ties. And somebody said today, what do you think about the Deadpool underwear? And I'm like, well, I'm not wearing it. I'm glad it exists. Okay, you're right here. You're in the front and you're wearing Deadpool, so thank you. Yeah. My family thanks you. I also have a chance. I've been working on that a long time. Riverside, rock on.
I've seen a lot of people. I've seen more Deadpool cosplayers than I have anyone else. There are people, I know someone else who dresses their dog as Deadpool and tells the dog.
Sure. There's a dog in the comics, by the way.
How do you feel about your once little small character becoming such a huge icon that everyone is like, everyone just knows who Deadpool is?
Okay, here's two things. One, I'm like that guy that goes, I take umbrage to this. Deadpool debuted in 750,000 comics. There hasn't been a comic book that has sold 750,000 in 20 years, not called Star Wars. His second appearance was in 1.2 million comics. I have that royalty check. I know, that was a great number. You go like this. He was in trading cards. He He had, the reason Deadpool got his own series so fast is because he blew up. Fans loved him the minute he landed, like Wolverine, like Boba Fett, like characters. So I'm not trying to scold you. I'll point this way. Don't do that wrong. But the thing is, merchandising, he took off 10 years ago, before there was a movie. Look, we're talking about this movie is 9 months old, right? It's beautiful, it's awesome. But prior to that, there was 100 Deadpool pops, and all this other Deadpool t-shirts, I have issues, all this stuff existed. That shirt right there, that guy's wearing, I mean, all this, I get all the merchandise, and I get counting on the merchandise, and I see the merchandise, and I know that he had become a movement. That's why, when they wouldn't make the movie, you're like, have you walked outside lately? Hey, Tom Rothman, dude! And he has on every day of the movie made in Sony. Who cares? I don't want to, I'm not in this for movies, I draw comics. Deadpool, it's awesome to see how much he's blown up, but he is the people's character. That's, I keep saying it's a movement. Donald Trump is not a movement. Deadpool! I signed the 1992 action figure. I've signed 6 of them today.
Wow.
He appeared in the comic, and 7 months later, he was an action figure. And that was my first, like, tickle moment, because I love toys. When people aren't looking, I love toys. Like, again, I embarrass my family all the time. You're getting another doll, Dad? Yes! I'm getting a doll! Deal with it! I have a statue of Deadpool in my office. It's not in the office, it's my family room. Deal with it. So anyway, how much time do I have? I'm way over. I am getting kicked off the stage, and I thank you. No. You guys are going to be nice to have a lot of your time. I'll be signing all day tomorrow, and I hope I see you there, and we can talk then. Thank you again.